The first talk that we're going to have this morning is going to be by Dima Daman from the University of Bristol. The title is Scaling Egocentric Vision, the Epic Kitchens Dataset.
Good morning. Thanks for the introduction. I'm glad to be presenting this work on behalf of researchers from the universities of Bristol, Toronto, and Catania. And our title is Scaling Egocentric Vision. There is a little need to explain why we need to scale all sorts of problems in computer vision and machine learning. And evidence showed us that when we collect large data, new challenges and opportunities arise. And in this case, we're focusing on the domain of egocentric videos. I hope that they are smooth at your end, but you're seeing a collection of videos showing people's daily activities, whether it is social interactions, object interactions, sports, navigation, and we believe this offers a unique viewpoint onto people's motivations, goals, multitasking, with potentials to be useful for human-to-robot imitation learning, as well as HCI, particularly with the increase in the amount of wearable hardware. However, this type of footage is not currently available online, so we can't just search for it in YouTube. We have to collect this largely unavailable source of video footage. And previous efforts have focused on collecting egocentric datasets. However, they're usually restricted to one location, an office kitchen or a smart home. Again, there are very few efforts that focused on maybe native or multiple environments, so people's homes, people's offices. However, they tend to be scripted, so people are given a script to enact in their homes. We wanted a non-scripted egocentric dataset that focuses on people's attentions, natural interactions, and I'll start by showing you a collection of the videos that we've captured. We particularly targeted kitchens because we believe it is the location in your home with the largest amount of complex object interactions. And I'm here to present to you Epic Kitchens. Right, so in the paper you'll see a comparison between Epic Kitchens and the six commonly used egocentric datasets for object interactions, as well as six third-person, so recorded remotely for people with object interactions. And we're significantly larger than all the egocentric datasets to date, and quite comparable to the third-person counterparts. We offer annotations for about 40,000 action segments and nearly 500,000 object bounding boxes. And I'll tell you more in the next phase how we managed, as universities, to collect and annotate such a large dataset, and that's by formulating a new pipeline. Right, so I'll start by telling you about the data collection. We had to collect our videos because these are not available online, and we focused on natural interactions in people's environments, collecting all what people do in their kitchens. So not only cooking, it's washing your dishes, preparing your breakfast, etc. And then if you collect such a large non-scripted dataset, the question is, how can you annotate? So we formulated a pipeline that starts by live narrations from the subjects themselves, which are used as weak labels to enable us to collect efficiently dense action segments and active object bounding boxes. And I'll end this talk by telling you about the benchmarks and the challenges that are currently open. So the data collection was formulated by giving people head-mounted GoPros with an adjustable mounting, which is very important to capture different environments and different people's heights. We asked people to start recording immediately before entering their kitchen, every day for 3 days, and stop recording only whenever they are stepping out of their kitchen. So it's all their kitchen activities recorded at full HD and 60 FPS. Giving you some types of footage, which I don't think we have in computer vision, like people making mistakes, parallel goals, they're still trying to close the bottle while they're making the dough. And we collected this in 32 kitchens. These are six single-person environments, so there's only one person in the kitchen, allowing us to release all the footage without any faces, in four different cities representing the collaborators between May and November, resulting in 55 hours from people with 10 different nationalities, just offering a variety of cooking styles and ingredients. And each person had to record for 3 consecutive days and all their kitchen activities. We released the data with the actual date and time of recording.
Pick up backpack. Unzip backpack.
People were then asked to
take
talk
salmon,
over whatever they have recorded in their native
take
language.
Take out salmon, put in fridge. Take out rice, drop on floor.
拿出砧板.
We realized people had to record in their native language because they are unable to know all the kitchen ingredients in their second language.
Κλείνω σιρτάρι, ανοίγω σιρτάρι, παίρνω ξύλο κοπής, κλείνω σιρτάρι.
Prendi coperchio, posa coperchio, prendi coltello, prendi tagliere.
Our decision to collect these narrations from the participants themselves is based on our belief that they are the people who know best what they've done, and this is their kitchen. And we opted for these post-recording narrations rather than while they're doing it, so they can carry their daily activities unhindered and then worry about the labeling after. This gives us weak labels, so rough alignments between the audio and the video gives you a location of that action, as well as a free-form description of the language, which of what they've done, which we transcribed using Amazon Mechanical Turkers, and in the case of other languages, we transcribed and translated. On average, we have a narration every 4.9 seconds out of our 55 hours, and these have been transcribed by multiple workers to check for correctness. Next is to take each narrated segment and simply adjust the start and end time using Amazon Mechanical Turkers. And in the paper, you can read about how multiple hits can be combined for agreements to result in the ground truth. And a sample of our action segments can be shown here, and you can see multiple parallel actions with multiple lines because there are significant amounts of overlapping actions that we do when we carry out our daily activities. Interestingly also, these actions differ significantly in their durations, some being very short, some much longer. On average, these are 3.7 seconds long, but you can also see the standard deviation. They're mostly very short actions and a few longer ones, giving rise again to opportunities to define new video analytics frameworks that can deal with very, very short actions as well as longer ones. Following that, we take these narrations and focus next on the active objects. So these are the objects that are used in that particular action. They could be one, they could be more than one. We augment the annotated start and end time with 2 seconds before and after to capture pre, during, and post interaction. And then we, every 2 frames per second, we ask Mechanical Turkers to annotate the bounding boxes, and we ask the same annotator to annotate 50 consecutive bounding boxes for consistency. And a sample of these bounding boxes with temporal overlaps are shown here. On average, we have 1.6 boxes per frame, and 77% of the frames we sent for annotation resulted in at least one bounding box. The next challenge we had to face is the free form. So we asked people to use any form of verb or noun they prefer, resulted in a collection of these verbs for the same interaction, like take, grab, pick, pick up, fetch, etc. We manually clustered these into minimally overlapping classes for the verbs, because there was no way of doing it automatically. For the nouns, we used a combination of automatic and manual checking. Still, after doing all this effort, we have 125 verb classes and around 331 noun classes. Note that some of these classes, a small number, are only available in the test set, enabling you to do some zero-shot learning using our data set. Again, because we collected natural interactions, we have a long-tail distribution. You can see the distribution for verbs here. Note that the y-axis is log-scaled, so this is a clear long tail with more than half of our data set formed of put, take, open, close, and wash in terms of verbs. The same applies to nouns. I have far more nouns, and you can see here the distribution of nouns, and we kind of gave you some general understanding that this represents food, vegetables, meat liquids, as well as cutlery, kitchenwares, as well as trash. So an interesting combination of types of visual things, and you can see here the histogram also of the bounding boxes of these active objects. Again, for object interaction, we believe there is a significant interesting challenge here, because some of our objects, like vegetables, occupy less than 10% of the frame, but other things, like fridges, when you interact with them, they're fairly large and mostly out of frame as you're interacting. So again, a significant difference in scale, which you might not face if you're dealing with images captured using Flickr or Facebook. Right, we offer 2 test splits. The first test split, we call it the scene test set. So for 28 kitchens, we reserved annotations for 20% of the sequences. So the full sequence is either in training or in testing. We call this the scene test set. We also reserve annotations for 4 kitchens. We call this the unseen test set, so people can evaluate the generality of their methods on novel environments. Some statistics on the training and the 2 test splits can be shown here. Note that we don't offer an official validation set, so we encourage you to try different combinations for parameter tuning and hyperparameter tuning before training on all the released annotations. In the paper, we define and provide baselines for 3 challenges: object detection, action recognition, and action anticipation. For object detection, the baseline we offer is using faster RCNN. Some qualitative results can be seen here. We restrict the images evaluated to the images annotated with the bounding boxes, with the active object bounding boxes. And we evaluate and compare results using mean average precision separately for the seen and the unseen test sets. And some results on our 15 most frequent object classes can be seen here, showing good performance for certain objects like a pan or a tap, including generality for unseen locations, harder challenge for smaller objects like knife, as well as objects that change appearance during your interaction, like meat and other types of food. And we separate the classes into few-shot and many-shot classes. The next challenge we release is the action recognition challenge. So that gives a trimmed action segment with a start and end time. And then given the video, including the audio, the challenge is whether you can identify the verb class as well as the noun class. And the combination of these verb and noun classes form the predicted action. We report results using two-stream CNN and temporal segment net squares as baseline, again, separately for the seen and the unseen, reporting accuracy as well as average plus precision and recall to handle the class imbalance. The some qualitative results show that the method is able, TSN, temporal segment network, is able to correctly detect many actions like mixing pasta or even actions in novel environments like opening drawer. However, it does struggle with actions that occur in the same location like fill versus wash or with actions where the objects seem to have similar appearances like cheese and onion. The third challenge is the action anticipation challenge. Given a trimmed sequence and an anticipation time, so a time you shouldn't be observing, then looking at any observed past of history, so again, you shouldn't be observing the anticipation time, which we fixed to 1 second, the challenge is again to predict the verb and the noun classes, and you can see the results of the baselines in the paper. We believe this data set offers a chance to define less explored new challenges, like visual dialogue, video summarization, skill understanding. We believe both our team as well as other teams will be able to define and release new challenges based on the videos and the annotations released. The dataset has been out there since April, so some of you might have already seen it. We've released the full videos with the audio, scaled RGB, and computed optical flow. The challenges have been opened 2 days ago alongside the EPIC workshop. They're currently available on Coda Lab, the three defined challenges, and they will remain as public leaderboards until CBPR, so please try them out, and if you have any questions, don't hesitate to ask us. If you have any questions about the dataset, the annotations, how we collected it, and maybe if you want to collaborate on future challenges, please visit our webpage, come to our poster, and if it's too busy, we're very easy to locate using our fairly large badges. Ask me about Epic Kitchens. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for the presentation. We'd like to take questions now from the audience. So if you have a question, if you could kind of wave to us so we know which part of the auditorium you're in, great.
Thank you, that's a great data set. Question is regarding the validation side. Why do you think it's a good idea actually to not define the validation side? Because when I review papers, too many cases, I see people just use the testing side and the validation side when the validation side is not defined.
Right, so the test set, if I understand your question, the test set is not released. So the test set is behind the validation server for both our seen and unseen sets. You only have the annotations for the training slash validation set. The test set is behind the server, and it will never be released, so you can only submit your predictions and see where you rank, enabling people not to overfit. The nice thing about our framework is that should people realize this is a solved challenge, we can simply go and collect further data and see whether we can scale to even maybe novel locations and novel environments. So the test set is not released.
Yeah, we have a question over here.
Hi, yeah, thanks for the great data set. A question about the narration. Mm-hmm. So do you feel that there's a possibility that by asking folks to say exactly what they're doing as they're doing it, you're making them make more mistakes?
Right, so I might have gone too fast over this. We haven't asked them to narrate while they're doing. Okay. So they finish their 3 days of recording, natural interactions in their kitchens without worrying about the labeling. They come back, they watch their videos and narrate over it. That's why we call it the live narration. And the idea is basically stealing all these brilliant data sets that are from movies, where there are these subtitles, so it's as if they're providing subtitles over whatever they've done, but not while they're recording it. While they're recording it, it's just very early in the morning, they just woke up, they put their headset, and they go to prepare coffee. There is no way they will give you any language in any form or shape. So it's actually post-recording, post the 3 full days being done.
Okay, great. We'd like to thank the speaker again for a great talk.